Now, there's one and only one rule in this class. I will tolerate no reenacting, whether it's ironic or sincere, of the Patrick Swayze Demi Moore pottery scene in Ghost. Ever since that movie was released in 1990, I have seen every conceivable variation of what I call ghosting. This could be guy on girl, girl on guy, the hilarious guy on guy.
What the hell happened to them? This season, we are making Whoopi. That's right, Whoopi Goldberg this season. Hangin Ten. I am your host, Patrick Skeyhill, and joining me on the line is white but cute Joe Vekeman.
I bet that's how Whoopi would describe me.
And on the audio boards is Lev Van Rensselaer, reminding me to remind you that you can email the cast at whathappenedtothemcast@gmail.com. And our sponsor this week is Gaspar, the friendly ghost director. Gaspar Noé's new experimental documentary where he takes a look back at his life as if he were a ghost and also helps strangers fix their life problems so he can get into heaven.
That is... Gaspar Noé is making that?
Yeah, Gaspar right. Noé, the friendly okay. ghost director.
Yeah, yeah. What do we watch this week? We watched 1990's Ghost.
That's right. Number 3 in our Hangin' 10. What did we skip over between this and Jumpin' Jack Flash?
Well, I want to let you know, though, that I looked it up this morning, and I believe all but one of these movies is on Tubi right now.
Yeah.
That we skipped over.
You mean the greatest streaming service ever created? Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes, that's good to
hear. Mm-hmm. So what did we skip over after Jumpin' Jack Flash? We skipped over 1987's Burglar, which is on YouTube.
Okay.
Fatal Beauty in 1987, which is on Tubi. The Telephone in 1988, which is on Tubi. Clara's Heart, which I believe is also on Tubi. Homer and Eddie from 1989, which I believe is also on Tubi. I looked these all up this morning. I was so happy. I'm going to go back and watch them. And then that leads us to 1990's Ghost. Directed by Jerry Zucker.
Is Homer and Eddie the movie that ties in Eddie and Homie Spumoni?
I mean, I don't know. I can't tell you, but I can give you a plot synopsis of that one.
Yeah, that's fine. But first, it's kind of like part of why we did Hangin' 10 was because we thought a lot of these movies would be aggressively hard to find. And it seems like a lot of these more obscure ones
are everywhere.
Just hanging out on. Like, this wouldn't have happened 2 years ago, right?
No,
like,
not at all.
2 years ago, these wouldn't have existed. That's the problem with the Julia Roberts season, that just some of these just were gone. But now, like, Tubi's coming in, it's like, yeah, just give us all your crap. Just dump it all here. It's fine.
I believe Satisfaction is on Tubi.
Jeez. What a great age we're in.
Tubi's great. If you can stomach, like, maybe 3 minutes of commercials for an hour and a half, you're good.
I barely even notice them anymore.
I really don't notice them at all. It's quite nice.
What's the synopsis of Ghost for like the 5 people who don't know what happens?
What's the plot synopsis of Ghost, you say? Well, I'll tell you. After a young man is murdered. How young do we think Patrick Swayze is?
32.
I'll look that up after. After a young man is murdered, his spirit stays behind to warn his lover of impending danger with the help of a reluctant psychic.
Yeah, let me say, I'm one of the 5 people who didn't know what happened in this movie.
Jesus.
I knew there's a guy and he's dead and he's like trying to hang out with his wife or whatever. So imagine my surprise when all of a sudden our plot takes a detour and I'm like, what? Money laundering? The mafia?
I know.
It's like the border all over again.
Patrick Swayze was 38.
At 38? Yeah, okay. Young man. Gotcha.
Hey, he's only a young man because we're only are poo-pooing the young man statement at that because we are still younger than him, but not for long.
Yeah, I know. His life's also much more put together than ours, too, but...
I mean, is it? He got shot. He's dead.
Yeah, you hear Demi Moore has the same origin story as Batman, and she does nothing with it. He handles it way better than Demi Moore does. Demi Moore, why aren't you off solving crimes and shit? You just moping in your apartment? That's not going to bring Patrick Swayze back.
I can't believe I never put together that is the same origin story as Batman. You can get out of a nice play of Macbeth.
Yeah.
He gets shot in the alley by some mugger.
And by the way, the same thing fucking happens in The Time Machine, the early 2000s cinema classic, The Time Machine. People, just give him your wallet. It's not worth it. Just fucking do it. Who cares?
Patrick, I need to remind you, this movie comes out like maybe 8 months after the original Batman movie.
Everybody's like, damn, I've seen this before. Like, could you imagine the version of Batman where Batman's parents die and Batman just goes home and cries a bunch and his parents are like, Batman, you've got to go fucking get out. Here's the criminal. Go get the Joker, which I know isn't the real origin story, but for the sake of 1989, I'm bringing it
up. Let me just get through most of this that I really want to point out right away. So this budget, can you tell me what the budget for this movie Ghost in 1990 was?
$50 million.
22 to 23 million.
Hey, perfect. That's how you do it, guys.
Now, do you know how much money this movie made?
$180 million.
Oh, wow.
Higher?
Yeah.
$300 million. Higher?
Higher.
Holy crap. $400 million? Oh my God.
It made $505.7 million worldwide.
That is very impressive.
Yeah.
Very impressive. It is. Well done.
It's very, very impressive.
Here I am wondering, I'm like, well, this movie came out in the summer? Well, how is this movie getting nominated for Oscars? Who's remembering it? Oh, it just kept playing into the fall.
Oh, yeah. No, no doubt. Yeah, this movie was.
They're like, oh, Halloween's back. Time to put back Ghost into the theaters.
Yeah, this movie was nominated for Best Picture, Best Original Score, Best Film Editing, and won Best Supporting Actress for Whoopi Goldberg, and Best Original Screenplay for Bruce Joel Rubin.
I saw it had won two Academy Awards, and I knew one was Whoopi, and I was hoping to God the other one was not the screenplay.
Oh. Because
this screenplay is not very good.
Oh, wow.
The directing... very good.
That's what I was. I really like the directing quite a bit.
It's not all hits, but there's a lot of really great moments in here.
There's some fun camera stuff in this.
The director putting in some actual effort. The script, not very good.
I like the script, but.
I would say not a great script. I would point to a couple things. The first one being this lowest hanging fruit, being this really weak Patrick Swayze can't say I love you arc. Feels crowbarred. We got to show an arc. We got to show that he, you know, we need him to love her, but he can't say he loves her. It's just words, but it means it's really hard for him, and we don't know why it's hard for him. But then he says it at the end, even though he technically says it in the middle. So that's just like a big like huff. But then there's
hold on before you move from that. That line, ditto, is in the movie because that's what the screenwriter used to say to his high school girlfriend all the time.
Yeah, that feels exact a high school thing. That's what it feels like. Patrick Swayze is a grown-ass man.
Love.
I don't care what the long line says. Yeah, yeah, young love with this proto-hipster New York crowd.
Wow.
Right? But really, like, kind of think about it, right? They move into a renovated warehouse apartment.
It's a nice apartment.
It has an art studio and a jukebox. She's got a pixie haircut.
Yeah.
They're gentrifying a seedy neighborhood that they're living in. Like, come on. Proto-hipsters. And by the way, is the fact that Patrick Swayze is falling in love with someone with Demi Moore's haircut in this film make a lot of sense when he's in Donnie Darko?
He likes the little boys in that movie, though.
Yeah, and Demi Moore's haircut is a little boy haircut.
That's so rude. That's so rude.
But, you know, true.
I guess, but so rude.
That's a little boy haircut. Did she just like come out of G.I. Jane? Is it like starting to grow back? Is that why we have the haircut?
So rude. G.I. Jane is in 1997, my friend.
Oh, jeez.
That's also, it's the no hair. She shaved it.
Yeah, no, so there's no hair, and then it starts to grow back, and now she's in Ghost. That was my thought.
That would have been a very early G.I. Jane, though.
I just, all the 90s kind of collapsed in on itself.
No, I had a lot of information for you. I got a lot of stuff on this.
Well, then the stupid thing, he's like, how do I touch things, weird subway ghost? And weird subway ghost.
Vincent Schiavelli?
Yeah, clearly PTSD subway ghost is like, well, you just got to feel it in your gut. So then we see like Patrick Swayze like try to touch a shoe. And Ghost is guy's like, no, you're not using your emotions. And then we see basically the same Patrick Swayze touch the shoe. And now the shoe moves. That is not good writing. This is what I'm telling everybody. It's not cinematic. It's really cheaty. And the ghost rules don't make any sense. He needs to take a subway, but sometimes he just appears places. Like, so if he's on the subway, then like he's being affected by inertia and gravity. You're just kind of making it up as you go. You basically just need Patrick Swayze to be able to touch or do something whenever you want him to. And sometimes people can hear him, and sometimes they can't. There's no inner logistics. I wanted to talk about later what other screenplays it was up against, because this is just not a fantastic screenplay. Go on.
I can tell you right now that no one gives a shit about the logistics of ghost shit like that. This movie made $500 million. No one cares.
But then don't give it the screenplay. It doesn't matter. If the audience likes it, that's fine. But we're not going to sit around and be like, wow, he really won a lot by cheating all the effing time. Wow, Patrick Swayze learned a lesson here. But he really didn't. Patrick Swayze, wow, learned to use his emotions. Why am I seeing his emotions ever get used then? You could have said, oh, you just got to sprinkle some fairy dust onto the shoe, Patrick Swayze. Then you can move the stupid shoe.
Okay, hold up.
Okay, go on.
Bruce Joel Rubin, the screenwriter of this film, started crying when he wrote Molly's Ditto.
What a great self-congratulatory story there.
I think that's so sweet, but you are just like not having it.
And there's a lot I like about this movie. Not that screenplay.
Bruce Joel Rubin got the idea for the film while watching a production of Hamlet. When Hamlet's dead father tells him to avenge his death, Rubin thought that would make a great movie. You like that one?
Fine, sure.
Jerry Zucker set out to make a movie that made you laugh, cry, and get scared. The movie is a roller coaster ride.
Did you get scared? You ever scared?
I mean, when I was like 7 or 8 and I saw this movie and I saw the fucking freaky shadow people, I was a little scared. Can I tell you something about those freaky shadow people? The sounds they got for that are slow down baby cries.
I like the creepy shadow people.
That's incredible.
You kind of weaken your climax because we are like, I thought I was waiting all movie. I'm like, okay, well, somebody's getting dragged to hell.
Oh yeah.
And then the murdery guy gets taken first. And I go like, okay, that was kind of that was a tasteful way to do that without like leaning too much in any one like religious direction. That's pretty cool. But then like, okay, so does that mean the other guy's not going to die? Because you already used it up here. No, they just did the exact same thing in pretty much the exact same manner.
Okay.
You already blew it. You blew your load too early, movie. You had to either not do it then or do something bigger for this one because he's like the real asshole.
One guy gets smushed by cars. The other guy gets stabbed by
No. But they all just get like taken by shadow people. Like it's did the same thing. And they're like within like 30 minutes of each other. Like some of the drama and tension has been kind of removed because now we know it's happening. Maybe even the guy like even just tries to put up more of a fight or something, like something to make it feel bigger and grander. You sort of just gave us the same thing twice. I'm already a little numb to it. You needed to expand it. It's not hard here. And I need you to, like when Whoopi Goldberg comes in, and I'm glad she comes in, but man, does this movie take a hard genre shift? It almost feels like we're not even in the same movie anymore. Like Patrick Swayze singing King Henry VIII, I feel like he's barely the same character. Like I need this more consistent.
Did you not hear the little detail about that?
Yeah, I know. That Demi Moore brings it up as a way to get her to believe. So fine, but I'm just saying, as I'm watching it, I go like,
That was what he did to get her to go on a date with him.
I just acknowledged that.
I thought that
I'm
was
just saying,
very silly and funny.
Yeah, it's silly, but like I had to be like, wow, this feels like a different movie, and then go back. And then when Whoopi leaves, we're back to the other movie, and then we're like annoying corporate espionage movie. And then it turns out that the bad guys aren't even like the rich Wall Street banker jerks. It's actually the mafia.
Oof.
It's not best screenplay. We'll take a look later at actual best screenplay winners and be like, how does this rank to them, Joe?
Well, I already know mine that year, but that's just my bias. But I also think it's
All right. I'm sorry. I like the movie.
Good.
I just didn't like the screenplay. I really, really didn't. I just want. We've seen this done better before. We've seen Ghost Story. I've seen it. I wanted that.
A ghost story.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, all right. Marry, murder, bang. Who would you marry? Who would you murder? Who would you bang? Patrick Swayze, Casey Affleck, or Bruce Willis?
Oh, God. Well, the whole thing with Casey Affleck is just, it's, you know, he's got some troubled history now. But I guess I'd murder him first. Because I just don't want to deal with his past. I'd marry Patrick Swayze because he's so gentle. And
he won't leave you in a corner, Joe.
No, exactly. And then Bruce Willis, yeah, sure, let's get it on.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
You say Casey Affleck has a troubled past? What's his past?
I don't want to go into that.
Uh-oh.
Allegedly.
Uh-oh. All right. Let's go back to the actual ghost movie we're talking about.
Yes, let me tell you. The role of Oda Mae Brown was not written with Whoopi Goldberg in mind.
You could fool me.
But Patrick Swayze, an admirer of hers, convinced the producers that she would be right for the part.
You guys have got to see the movie Citizen. She is a tour de force. Is that what Patrick Swayze was saying to them?
I'm pretty sure he was like, have you seen The Color Purple? Where she was nominated for Best Actress.
The Color Purple wouldn't make you think she'd be good for this role. Something like Jumpin' Jack Flash would.
Her credentials are with her last few movies. Yeah, definitely.
On the one hand, I want to say this seems like, especially for a movie that came out in the summer, this seems like an odd role that would stick in Academy voters' minds to vote for Best Winner. But on the other hand, I'll say she fucking steals the whole movie.
Yep.
She is a great performance that's enjoyable. I got myself in the middle being like, I want Whoopi back. Give me Whoopi. I didn't like the non-Whoopi parts of the movie. I thought she was a welcome element to it. And I thought she worked really hard. She had to kind of actually do some hard stuff where she has to like he's actually there, obviously.
Yeah.
But she has to pretend she's not there and like, I don't know, react to things. And she had some work to do there. And I think she kind of, that stage background kind of kept it, that comedian background kind of kept her working well with it.
Yeah, when like he has to jump into her body, and like the
she also sometimes has to pretend to be the other people, and
yeah, just jump into a different character. Like, ooh, yeah, here we go. Yeah. All right, let me tell you, best supporting actress that year.
Yeah,
feels a little heavy. We have Mary McDonnell for Dances with Wolves. I'm starting.
Louis's not great, but okay.
Lowest to.
Okay, gotcha. I gotcha.
Annette Bening, The Grifters, movie I haven't seen. But I've heard good things. Diane Ladd for Wild at Heart.
Okay. I could see why they wouldn't give it to her.
Yeah, well, that's a crazy performance.
And just because
it's
the acting style that's not really in their taste.
Yeah. Lorraine Bracco for Goodfellas.
Very, very minor role.
That is so not true. What are you talking about? When was the last time you watched Goodfellas?
I just think that's not the thing that's standing out much, is what I
think. I think you're crazy. I will take you to the craps table on that, and I will knock you down.
On the crafts table?
The crafts table. We're going to have some craft services.
We're going to have food? Okay.
Yeah, we're going to hash this out over food.
Okay.
And Whoopi Goldberg for Ghost.
Yeah, I've only seen those three films, so I can't really put up a good argument. It doesn't seem like a strong year.
I think it's a strong year out of just those three. And if I saw The Grifters, I would probably have four.
I mean, Annette Bening, obviously a talented actress, so I'm sure she's in the conversation. But I would be shocked out of my mind if Diane Ladd were ever in the actual running for that award.
Is she the only one nominated from that movie?
And it's
too?
Not because she's bad. It's just because it's a very specific acting style David Lynch has, and the Academy tends to vote for a more realistic is not the right term, but something along what they view as being realistic for Hollywood standards. And that is not what happens in David Lynch films.
I think it's just her, she's the only nomination, though, so.
Yeah, and it's just because, like, she's just, like, been around forever. So it's like, Diane Ladd, let's give her something. Let's give her a little nod.
Well, I watched that movie, like, 2 months ago, and she's really, really interesting. And
yes, interesting, yes. David Lynch is really works well at getting interesting performances out of people. But he does not get them awards because his acting's all weird. Like, he worked really hard at the Emmys for Twin Peaks to get Kyle MacLachlan a nod, which felt kind of fair because he played, like, 4 different characters.
Yeah.
Didn't give it to him. Like, he just, it's just not what they're going for. It's crazy. Just, I think the success story is that she got nominated at all because it's just not what they're going for.
That is a good point. All right. Our second win of the night at the Oscars was the best screenplay, which you've had.
I've had many, many quibbles with.
Yes. It was nominated against Metropolitan, Whit Stillman.
I don't know that one.
Green Card, Peter Weir.
I don't know that one.
Avalon, Barry Levinson.
Nope.
Alice, Woody Allen.
Okay, I know that one. I don't know. I can't complain because I don't know any of these.
Well, I'll check out the Peter Weir and Whit Stillman movies, but
I mean, I think there is something to say about the fact that I have not heard of those, but I have heard of Ghost.
I wonder if they're just even lesser of those other directors, too. I don't know, because I've heard of those directors.
Some of those are famous directors. But, like, what else has won Best Screenplay, like, in the last 10 years? Like, what are some standouts?
In our timeline of the last 10 years?
In our last 10 years. Like, what's the quality they're doing these days? Like, okay. Is it just always bad ones?
I'll write them down for you. Just give me 1 second.
Like, what won last year? I can't even remember.
What won last year?
Yeah.
What did win last year?
Because now I'm thinking, like, this compared to the Tar screenplay. But then I thought, you know what? The Tar even win best screenplay? I don't even know.
No. I don't think Tar won anything last year.
That's fucking a crime.
Best original screenplay went to Everything Everywhere All at Once.
Okay, go on.
It was nominated against The Banshees of Inisherin, The Fablemans, Tar, and Triangle of Sadness.
Triangle of Sadness, another excellent script.
I hated that fucking movie. That movie's so annoying, stupid.
That was great.
I'm going to skip over the 2020 year because that was just a
pandemic year.
Yeah. Belfast won for original screenplay in 2022.
Okay, go on.
Yeah. It was nominated against The Worst Person in the World, or Licorice Pizza.
I never got to Licorice Pizza. It just kind of, I was waiting and then it just passed me by and I forgot.
Okay. I believe in 2019, the 2020 Oscars.
Well, can I talk about The Worst Person in the World being nominated? Like America's so starved for original screenplays, they had to nominate something from outside the country.
Yeah.
Can I just want to point that out.
Yeah, well, that's what happened in 2019 for the 2020 Oscars. Parasite won Best Original Screenplay that year.
Yeah, but that one it was also Best Picture nominated, so I don't know.
I mean, it's still crazy that a Korean film won Best Screenplay, Best Picture. It took Best
Director.
I think it
won Best Screenplay because of the momentum. Like, I don't know how many people were actually sitting down and reading that screenplay. Okay. I think it just kind of got caught up. If it hadn't won and had been nominated, I'd be like, I get you. Worst Person in the World, like, that's kind of crazy to me.
I'm going to read you the winner from 2018 at the 2019 Oscars for Best Original Screenplay. Have you heard of a movie called Green Book?
Jesus. Yeah, right? It won that early.
The fact that Green Book was nominated against The Favorite, First Reformed, Roma, and short, Vice.
I remember that award came down and you texted me and you're like, I'm getting kind of worried here, Patrick. And I went, no, that could never win Best Picture. That'd be ridiculous. Well, you were right, that one. I owe you a Coke, I guess.
And in 2017, it was Get Out.
That one seems fine.
That was a pretty good year, I thought.
Green Book. Okay. I guess they are just kind of voting for the crowd pleaser things. There's some cracks in every... I like Everything Everywhere All at Once, but I think there's some cracks in that screenplay, too. Green Book, I think, is a bad screenplay.
What did you think of Manchester by the Sea?
So I didn't like the movie, but I actually like the... I don't know how to phrase this. I like the screenplay itself. Like, I like...
Me too.
The formatting of it, I think, is kind of wild. And I also think, like, looking at the page, but I also think the fact that you could watch that dialogue and presume that it was a lot of improvisation, but it turns out they're actually reading the script word for word. I think, well, finally someone's writing some goddamn good dialogue here at long last. Hollywood's figured that out. So that one, I have no quibbles with.
Okay. Really quick, I just also want to run through Jerry Zucker, the director of this movie's filmography.
Okay.
Are you ready? There's only a few. There's like six movies, okay? First movie was Airplane.
Oh, wow. Very different. Okay.
1984, Top Secret.
Okay, I'm seeing a pattern.
1986, Ruthless People.
I don't know that one.
I think that's a Danny DeVito movie. Yeah, with Judge Reinhold, Bette Midler, Bill Pullman.
Okay, the pattern continues.
Yes. In 1990, he made Ghost.
How the hell did he get Ghost?
Well, because the other three movies that I just listed off were co-directed with Jim Abrams and David Zucker. Yeah, this is a solo effort from Jerry Zucker.
I just said, like, ah, we got this moment movie that has some high drama in there. Who can we get? How about that Airplane guy?
Well... His brother, David Zucker, in the meantime, was directing The Naked Gun, The Naked Gun 2.5.
He never got out.
Basketball. My Boss's Daughter. Scary Movie 3 and 4.
The Scary Movie 1 and 2, Guys Too Good to Come Back.
The Wayans Brothers? Yeah. They took it in a different direction. Anyways, have you heard of a movie called First Night with Sean Connery, Richard Gere?
I have.
Jerry Zucker followed up Ghost with that.
Well, that movie I don't think did very well, did it?
No, I'll tell you. It did pretty darn well. $55 million budget, $127 million. Not bad.
Pretty good. I'm sure they're hoping for the home run like Ghost, but did just fine.
And then they followed it up. And when I say they, I mean Jerry Zucker. Followed that whole thing up with... Rat Race. That's his last movie.
And then he like gave up, or like he's like, I got all this Ghost money, I'm fine.
He's probably just chilling on Ghost money. I wonder what $505 million adjusted for inflation from 1990 is today.
Time to ask Professor Google.
Screenwriter Bruce Joel Rubin wanted Patrick Swayze to play Sam Wheat after he saw an interview Swayze gave. When he brought up his father, Swayze became emotional and began to weep. Ruben thought if a macho guy like Patrick Swayze could cry over a loved one, he'd be perfect for this movie.
Is he macho?
Well, he had just done a couple of... he did Roadhouse?
Oh, man. Are you ready for this?
Tell me.
Here's how much Ghost would have made in the year 2023. I mean, not actually, because this movie wouldn't have either gotten made or done very well, but it would have made $1.2 billion.
Hell,
this would
yeah.
have been the Avengers.
I love it. I love it so much. It took several months for director Jerry Zucker and writer Bruce Joel Rubin to come up with Sam's last line in the film. I just did that for you. This was the most rented video cassette of 1991.
Yeah, that's a stat we can't do for much longer, can we?
The video cassette. This stat is crazy, though. The highest grossing film during the calendar year was Ghost. The highest grossing film during the calendar year 1990. It was the box office champ for that year when 1991 began, but Home Alone, at November 1990 release, earned so much money between January and July 1991 that it took the number one slot for 1990 away from Ghost. But the worldwide box office, however, was another story. Home Alone grossed $476.6 million worldwide, but Ghost sailed past it with a take of 505.7. Those are two movies that were made for like $20 million each. Isn't this the argument for smaller budget movies?
That's always my argument. Yeah, listen, Hollywood, it can be done. your movie can be just as good.
It's also not filled with, like, characters you know. It's just, they're small, like, one's a family story. The other is, I guess, a more of a supernatural thing, but only in the back half, I guess.
Hold on. What was the budget on this movie?
$22 to $23 million.
So the movie actually would have cost about $54 million today. Still mid-sized.
Yeah.
They're still in the budget range. That's no-no territory, but...
Yeah, but if it was budgeted for $50 million and it made $1
billion... $1.2
billion. Yeah, I'm just saying, like, that's
still
you're better
quite
off.
The success. I agree. I agree. I just wanted to... You know, $20 million today, very different from $20 million last time.
Oh, yeah. Jerry Zucker didn't want to focus on Carl with his shirt off, so he filmed a lot of close-ups. Can't have too sexy, man.
Yeah, you spent this stupid thing where, like, you made him take off his shirt so he could seduce it, and you didn't even... I saw it, like, one shot in a wide, and that was it. And I said, why did you bother? What was the fucking point?
Yeah, it's so strange.
Oh, yeah, that's the other thing. It is so embarrassingly telegraphed that he is going to be... The guy doing whatever weird bank stuff's going on and try to steal his girlfriend from, like, minute 5 of the film.
I would say from second 30.
Yeah.
It's, when they're both taking, like, when they're both, both their shirts are off, his abs are a lot more sculpted than Swayze's. And I'm like, that's on purpose. That is so on purpose.
Patrick Swayze's like, yeah, she makes art or whatever. And he's like, I think this is brilliant. And I go, okay, well, I guess he's going to try to move in on her after you die, Patrick Swayze.
It is very telegraphed.
And then stuff's going on at the bank, and he's getting all weird about it. And I go, is there, like, going to be a weird, annoying bank plot line? Is he going to try to kill Patrick Swayze? That would be so stupid. And then it's a Batman thing. But then it turns out he paid the Batman guy, so...
The Batman guy? That's not how this movie goes.
Fine.
You can't pay the Batman guy.
The guy who kills him and turns him more into Batman. Like, that's basically what happens.
Luis Guzman, who was considered for the role of Willy Lopez, revealed in a documentary focused on character actors that he's frequently stopped by fans of the movie who think he's the actor who played Sam's killer.
I mercifully have not made that mistake. Just saying.
Oh, good. That's the first time that's ever happened.
Well, I don't think they look alike. I think that's helpful.
Well, Luis Guzman is... I think he's even pushed past character actor. I know his name. I've known his name for a while. He's been a lot of things.
Yeah, because you watch Paul Thomas Anderson films religiously.
Also, he's popped up in a couple of Adam Sandler movies.
Yeah, that's true. And he played himself in an episode of Community. Like, he's...
Yeah.
We know him. That's why we know him.
And then people ask him why he killed Patrick Swayze, to which he replies that's Rick Aviles, the actor in question, was the one who did it. So that's kind of sad. He's getting, that's not okay.
Well, Rick Aviles does not have a statue of himself at Greendale Community College, so.
He does not. Oh. When it came time to cast the film, writer Bruce Joel Rubin suggested Patrick Swayze for the role of Sam Wheat. The makers screened Swayze's movie Roadhouse from 1989, but director Jerry Zucker felt that Swayze was completely wrong for the part. Many actors that included Kevin Bacon. I'm gonna go through the actors now. You tell me if they're good or bad.
Yeah, seems fine.
In this role. Mm-hmm. Alec Baldwin.
I don't know.
No.
He should play the other guy.
He's too aggressive. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Nicolas Cage. Sorry, no.
But I don't think he's a good actor, so that's that.
Are we going to have a fight right now?
We can save that fight for the Nick Cage season.
Jesus Christ. the season that will go till the day we die. Kevin Costner. No.
No.
I'm just going to say that right now. No. Tom Cruise. No. I love Tom Cruise. No. Johnny Depp. No.
Johnny Depp's close, but I just think he's a little too weird.
He's also really young.
Yeah, that's fine. He's a young man, Joe. He's just a little too weird for what you want that. What you want the audience to get from them, right? You want kind of the everyman sort of thing to them.
This is the same year as Edward Scissorhands.
Exactly, yeah.
So, your point. David Duchovny.
Fine.
Yeah. Harrison Ford. No, too hot. Too hot, maybe too old at that point. He's definitely, like, heading towards middle age at that point. He's older than Swayze. Mel Gibson. No! These are all bad choices.
Mel Gibson at the time, I think, would have been a pretty good choice if you cut his hair.
From coming off of Lethal Weapon, where he's a crazy guy? He's crazy. He's not sweet and gentle.
I think he'd be sweet and gentle. He knows what women want, Joe.
Fuck off. Tom Hanks.
Yeah, fine. Not an exciting choice.
I would make him like number three out of the ones.
I think the hard part with Tom Hanks is he couldn't do the other half, the like whatever action movie part we're in. When he's like a man with a vendetta, I don't think he's like the best at that.
Yeah, because he's got the comedy stuff down pat.
Yeah. I think he could do. I think he could hang with Whoopi real easy.
Yeah. Oh god, there's so many of them. This one is outrageous, though, and it's just because he's a man of the time. And when I mean man of the time, I mean he's had a big hit.
Nick Nolte?
Fuck off. I love Nick Nolte, but no. Paul Hogan.
Oh, yeah. There you
Crocodile
go.
Crocodile Dundee himself.
Would he have had the accent?
I don't know, but instead he made a movie called Almost an Angel. Kind of funny. Kevin Kline. Coming off an Oscar.
That's an interesting choice. I've completely forgot about him.
Dennis Quaid.
Hey, you love Dennis Quaid.
I do like Dennis Quaid. Something to talk about.
He gave you something to talk about, indeed.
This one, absolutely no, but maybe for the other guy again. Mickey Rourke. Just like, what?
Not Patrick Swayze, too aggressive. Mickey Rourke, yes.
This guy, John Travolta.
John Travolta feels kind of weird, too. Am I just making that up after the fact?
No, you're absolutely right. He was making Look Who's Talking at the time.
Okay, there you go.
And last, but certainly not least, a man that I said on this very podcast that I would bang.
Bruce Willis.
Demi Moore's husband at the time, who didn't think the film would work. So that's why he said no. He was
Bruce
like, this
Willis
is going to work.
Did not think the thing would work. Made $500 million. He said, well, you know what? Joke's on you. I'll be in my own extremely successful ghost movie. Losers.
Yeah, I mean, he is coming off of his very own beginning of a franchise, Die Hard. Very, very, very successful.
Yeah.
And he's also coming off a very successful TV show called Moonlighting, which is on Hulu right now. Check it out.
Do you think he was like, not enough action here. The action's done all wrong, you idiots. I'll show you how it's done. You got to keep him in the building the whole time, you idiots.
He's just like, because my last movie took place in one building. That's your reasoning behind that. Okay. Oh, let's go to a segment that you like to do. And it's
Roger. We're going to see what Roger thinks.
Roger. Oh, I'll look up Roger after. Bruce Joel Rubin believes that two things date the film. The computer monitors and Arsenio Hall. What do you think dates the film? The word ditto?
No, ditto became popular when we were growing up because the Pokemon was named Ditto, Joe.
I was
going to
say that too.
It's the only reason why I knew what the word meant.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I feel bad for Arsenio being a dated reference. That's kind of... But, like, it also, like, that's what Whoopi would be
stands
watching.
Up for him.
Like, it makes sense. Yeah. Like, I wouldn't change that. You could pick goddamn Jay Leno, who wasn't even on TV at the time. Like, that would have been dated. Like, I'm sorry. You haven't watched
Letterman.
TV. It's going to be dated. Letterman was not on TV yet.
What? 1990? Really?
He was on The Late Late Show after Johnny Carson. And he was promised Johnny Carson's job... And then wasn't given it because they went with Jay Leno. So then he went over to CBS.
Jesus, Leno's really pushing everybody out of the picture there for a while.
Yeah, and then comes back and pushes people out again.
Yeah, The David Letterman Show, 1980. Late Night with David Letterman, 92 to 93. Late Show with David Letterman, 93 to 2015. So let's talk some Whoopi on this. We haven't talked much about Whoopi. She's great in this. She got an Oscar.
I really enjoyed it. I don't know if I'd call it Oscar worthy, but... Hearing who she's up against, you know what? Fine. And again, she steals the movie. Like, she's the most fun part of the movie. She's the character I was looking forward to seeing the most after they first introduced her.
Yes.
I think it feels like she's in a very different movie for most of the time she's in the movie, which is hard for me to grok with. And then it feels weird when she's at the action part at the end. I'm like, I don't think you're using her very well here at all. But it makes sense, I guess, that you would cast her in this role because she has done, I presume, in between Jumpin' Jack Flash and this, more comedies.
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
When I thought this was just like straight supernatural romance thing, I'm like, oh, I wonder why you put Whoopi in this. That's kind of weird. And then I'm like, oh, you just, you know, shoehorned in another genre. That's why you put her in here and it works out just fine.
She also got some great outfits again.
Yes, another movie, another standout outfit from Whoopi Goldberg in this weird pink dress that I think Marge Simpson wore in an episode of The Simpsons once.
She also has straightened hair.
Oh, yeah, I didn't even notice that. Yeah.
Dreadlocks.
So I wonder if that was like a phase she was going through or if that was like a director choice.
Huh.
It's interesting,
know.
Right?
Yeah.
We'll think on that. We'll track the dreads as we move through the movies.
Okay.
See if there's a pattern involved at all.
Should we dive into some Whoopi? Whoopi?
Yeah, so we've also, folks, so I bet none of you remember, but for us old timers, in the early 2000s, Whoopi Goldberg had a season of a TV show on NBC that I actually watched when it was on.
Yeah, is it actually from 2003, so it is 20 years old now?
Yes, I think it was either the 2002-2003 season or 2003-2004. It was one of those middle school years.
It is 2003-2004. September 9th, 2003 to April 20th, 2004.
I guess that's our eighth grade then?
Yeah, that's eighth grade. We were about to be freshmen in high school.
We have yet to meet yet.
Yes, that's true.
It's like the year before we met, there's this show coming on TV.
Yes.
And I would come home and I would be excited for Tuesdays. There was a couple of good shows on. I oddly don't remember them now. Oh, Frasier was on Tuesdays and this show was on Tuesdays.
Last season of Frasier?
Yeah, that would have been the last season. Mm-hmm. So I liked it and then we watched it again. Joe found it on YouTube. You cut up into thirds.
Yeah, the last like eight episodes are in halves though.
I, having watched the show, liked it more than I remembered liking it.
That's so funny.
I know you brought up a lot of the jokes on there that they can't make anymore, which I agree with, but I still found them amusing.
Yeah, no, it's amusing. It's just I'm laughing, but I'm like, is this okay to laugh?
I know. I like her character, this former singer.
Yeah, she has one famous song.
Yeah, she's a one-hit wonder and now owns a hotel, but like is always dreaming of her glory days. And she has her brother who acts very white. And he's dating this white girl who acts very black.
And that is really troubling sometimes. But I feel like it's okay in the sense that when Whoopi looks at her, she gives her this look and then she either goes along with the joke or she makes this girl the butt of the joke.
Yeah, we're making fun of what this girl's doing, but my God, is what this girl's doing a hysterical idea. I just like the dynamic of it between her, Whoopi, and the brother. I think it just all is like a really funny, you know, trio that they have there.
I enjoy the show.
Show's funny. I do like it. The Persian guy really wants us to know that he's Persian. I get it, but...
Also in the second episode where it's all about a suitcase...
That they think is... They're making jokes about Homeland Security and like the color warning systems. Very topical.
Yeah, like, and especially in 2003 when it's like, we had just gone over.
It's legitimately 2 years out. Like, we're not fully moved on yet.
And I don't know if America was ready yet. I'm sorry at that point. But I mean, I will tell you the ratings for this show are astounding.
Yeah.
And the fact that it got canceled is absurd. Anyone that would get a 15.1 million for their pilot,
know,
I'm like, wow, this thing's going to be offered the next 10 years.
Yeah.
This thing's not going away forever.
It was a different time.
Sign those contracts.
We know.
Did you have a favorite out of the three episodes we watched? So we watched the pilot, Don't Hide Your Bag, and Once Bitten. Once Bitten is about a ferret that bites Whoopi's hand, and it's a
Whoopi at the clustered New York medical hospital and like railing against the health insurance system.
Yeah.
I found that quite an amusing bit. Is that the one with the TV thing too when the guy from Just Shoot Me's there?
The TV
Or is that the
thing.
Suitcase one? Yeah, she's like trying to buy the new TV and the TV salesman.
That's the first episode.
That's the first one? Okay. Yeah, I think it's, third, first, second.
Yeah, I believe that TV guy who I thought was, oh my God, why can't I remember his name? The guy from, he was in the last Whoopi Goldberg movie. He's been in a bunch of Sandler movies. He's John Lovitz. I thought it was John Lovitz for a second, but it's Enrico Colantoni from Veronica Mars.
Veronica Mars and Just Shoot Me.
Yeah, well, I know him from Veronica Mars. He's the dad of
You do, you nerd.
Wow.
Yeah. All the Veronica Mars nerds out in the world. Yeah.
All 10 of us.
Yeah.
Well, I think my favorite was the hospital one, the one spit, when she gets bit by a ferret. I like that one.
That's good. You get to see an extra dimension to the other female character that acts black. Like, you know, we round her out a little more.
Yeah. She works at the hospital?
It looks like she's a doctor, but sometimes she acts like a maid.
Well, they have a maid.
Not a maid, a nurse. I meant a nurse, which is the maids of a hospital.
Wow. Wow.
No offense to the nurses. You're criminally underutilized and underpaid and under...
Valued.
But it looks like she's a doctor, and I think that would be kind of a funnier use of her than just making her a nurse. I think she's like this well-educated woman, and she has chosen this type of lifestyle.
Yeah.
Sometimes you go back and watch those shows and you're like, yeah, okay, whatever. I was, you know, 13 at the time. I probably, that was funny enough for me then. It's still, I think I like it more now than I did back then. I think I get a lot more.
I definitely understand
now.
It better to watch it now than I was when I was a child.
So we'll keep checking in on Whoopi for you as we go through the season. It's only got the one season. We should be able to finish it up pretty easily.
We will finish it right at the end of our last episode because you've timed it up perfectly.
Does not pass the Bechdel test. There's only two women, and they're always talking about Patrick Swayze. It's fact the only reason why they are talking.
My last looks on Ghost. I love Ghost. This is definitely the first time I've watched it in over 10 years. So it was a fun revisit, and I feel like I learned some things. Things I learned were, hey, Jerry Zucker, why don't you try again? This is fun.
The Patrick Swayze being dead reveal, I think, worked, right? Because we hear something, and then we see Patrick Swayze one off screen. We presume he's still alive. Like, I think that was great. Like you said, he had some good one-ers in the office during these high tense moments.
Oh my God. The one when they exit the elevator and it goes all around the office, and I rewound it. I'm like, is that just one take? That was incredible.
That was one take.
There's
that was
so
great.
Much going on, too.
We're worrying about the Japanese business deal going on. You know, Whoopi turning into Patrick Swayze. Like you did put in a lot of effort, and I'm finding out you did Airplane, which again,
those have different gags. Yeah,
they're different types of directing, and those obviously work too. But that's like comedy directing. This was like traditional drama directing, and it worked. Worked well.
And you made $500 million. This one movie.
My last looks are, what are Whoopi's pajamas in this? You think there'd be a little trap door on them, right?
Why does she need a trap door? That's not how it works.
She's in like the onesie thing, right? And when the kids have them, they got the little trap
the
doors. Yeah, talking about the butt. No. Obviously not my trap. My last looks are... My last looks are, would that romance pottery sex scene work as well if they use the scene from The Shining? No, that's not my last looks either. My last looks are, I much prefer Drew Carey's afterlife antics to Swayze's. No, those obviously aren't my last
looks. Wow, you're going on today.
No, my last looks are, great use of Whoopi. An outstanding use of Whoopi.
Excellent.
Goldberg. It's probably not a great sign that your third billed actor steals the spotlight from all your other characters, but
you know, we haven't given up. I feel like we have a little short shrift to Demi Moore. She was incredible in this too. She's so good.
She's good, but there's like large chunks where she's just gone from the movie too, and I'm like, are we gonna go back to Demi Moore? I really thought this was a romance thing. She's absent for weird chunks of the movie. It's like in Ghost Story where, you know, Rooney Mara just was like, all right, I'm peacing out. See ya.
She was very full from that pie.
I thought we were gonna do the same with Demi. I'm like, where'd she go? Whoopi Goldberg, excellent. I just really like, I don't know. I like Whoopi Goldberg's obviously enjoyable, but I've never left a movie and been like, damn, Whoopi Goldberg stealing scenes left and right. She's just bringing something here.
Well, this sets up her whole 90s, like, starring career.
Yeah, I'm not surprised she got, you know, she's in 400 things after this. Like, this was great.
I know. It's so wonderful.
Much better than Jumpin' Jack Flash.
Wow. Okay. I like that movie, too, but yes, I agree.
Specifically her.
I would say much better. I would say better.
Her is just much more enjoyable to watch in this movie than that movie. Much more. Okay. Not that I didn't like her in that movie, either. And not that that script also wasn't nominated for Academy Award, but... movie itself, good. Bad script. But sometimes good movies can come from, you know, mediocre scripts. And sometimes you think the script's better because of it. Because I don't think Academy voters read scripts. I think they left the movie, they're like, I had some emotions. It must have been the script.
I think you're absolutely right.
Because your actors aren't getting any awards. Your directing isn't getting any awards. And I think those elements, those three elements, Demi, Swayze, and Zucker... much more pivotal in all the things that made the movie successful than the script itself.
I agree.
All right, well, I want to thank our sponsor, Gaspar's The Friendly Ghost Director. That movie sounds like a trip, we'll call it.
Sounds like a nightmare.
I'd like to thank Van Rensselaer for minding those audio boards and keeping the sound so slippery smooth. I'd like to thank my co-host, Joe Vekeman, for stopping by.
Oh, thank you for having me.
And I am your host, Patrick Scaly. You may find my features, documentaries, short films, video essays, animations, behind-the-scenes footage, and so much more at QuixoticUnited.com and social media, presumably with a similar-sounding name. Thank you for listening, Joe. Say goodnight.
Good night. What does Scooby do?
Well, Joe, everybody wants to know, how did you spend your Godzilla day this year?
What day was that?
That was Friday.
Friday.
11-3. But on 11-1, they were also showing Godzilla 2000 in honor of Godzilla Day. That was Godzilla Day observed.
What did I watch on Godzilla Day, or what did I do? I watched the terrible, despicable, awful Dutch.
You know, I give a little Ed O'Neill bump to it.
Yeah, I like Ed O'Neill just like the rest of us, but Jesus. No one can save that piece of shit.
Yeah, not ideal. Not a great movie. And Christopher Plummer, neither of them can pull their weight.
Christopher Plummer, wow.
Not Christopher Plummer. Did I say Christopher Plummer?
Yeah, he meant McDonald.
Yeah.
Christopher Plummer's great, though.
Yeah, but not in the movie.
Yeah.
Nor is he in a Godzilla film.
That's too bad. I'm sure he would have liked to have been. He's dead, right? I think he died.
He died right after replacing Kevin Spacey?
No, he definitely died like a year ago.
When did that other movie come out? That wasn't a year
ago?
He
died in February of 2021. He has my son's birthday! Another one! We found another one with my son's birthday!
Okay, Joe, that's almost like 2 years ago. Don't act like it just happened.
I guess.
That is 21 months ago. My goodness.
That's a long time, actually.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I mean, but you said he went out on All the Money in the World, which is 2017. He really went out on Knives. Yeah, he went out on Knives Out in 2019.
I thought All the Money in the World was like 2 years ago. Oh, God.
That's so funny. No, that movie is ancient.
Oh, good. Well, was not a big, not a lot of stuff going on over here for Godzilla Day, unlike last year where it seemed to be everywhere. But that's okay, because next year is the big 70th anniversary, so maybe there'll be a big fun thing. And I just watched like 4 Godzilla movies that day. It wasn't the best use of my time, but I did it anyway.
Are we going to talk some Whoopi? Are you ready to Whoopi?
I'll Whoop you. I'll Whoop you good.
Oh!
I'm drinking water. What's going on?
It's July 13th, but that's 6 months from, or 5 months from, my son's birthday.
Who's July 13th?
The day that Ghost comes out.
Okay. I'm done talking about your son's birthday.
Yeah.